Good morning, children. So this is the second module on the chapter Journey to the End of the Earth. I think what we have done in the previous one, in the previous module, is very much clear to you. We have read that how a group of students just went to Antarctica with Geoff Green, okay? And the name of the program is Students on Ice. We also come to know about the Gondwana was a very supercontinent, and how many species of flora and fauna just prospered there. And we also come to know that if you want to come know about past, present and future, one must visit Antarctica. Why? Because it has not been changed because human beings is not able to reach there. So we just see very little change in Antarctica. Just it's all a barren because there are no human markers, there are no trees, buildings or billboards. Okay, there are only huge icebergs are there. And it also says that there are blue whales, and but there are also tiny things too. So till here we have read it. So let's start, continue with the same chapter, Human Impact. Human civilizations have been around for a paltry 12,000 years. Barely a few seconds on the geological clock. So he says that human civilization have been around a very small, paltry is a very small, that is to 12,000 years. That is a very few seconds if we just see on the geological clock. In that short amount of time, we have managed to create quite a ruckus, etching our dominance over nature with our villages, towns, cities, mega cities. So he says that if we just see on the geological clock, within 12,000 years, we have really created a lot of noise. Ruckus is a noise, and etching means a printing, means we have printed our dominance over the nature in these 12,000 years. We have created villages, towns, cities and mega cities. The rapid increase of human populations have left us battling with other species for limited resources, and the unmitigated, means completely bad, burning of fossil fuels has now created a blanket of carbon dioxide around the world, which is slowly but surely increasing the average global temperature. So within this 12,000 years, what we gain, we have made villages, towns, cities, mega cities, and with the increase of the population, there is very limited natural resources are there, okay? And because of the burning of fossil fuels, we have created a blanket of carbon dioxide around the world, which is slowly but surely increasing, slowly and gradually we are just increasing the global temperature. Climate change is one of the most hotly contested, means disputed, environmental debates of our time. With the West Antarctic ice sheet melt entirely, will the Gulf Stream ocean current be disrupted means prevented. He says that we have seen that how Antarctic ice sheets are just melting. So will the Gulf Stream ocean current be prevented or not? Will it be the end of the world as we know it? So as we have seen so many changes around us in the nature, in the temperature, in the world. So are these the signs that really the world is going to end now? Maybe, may not be, we don't know. Either way, Antarctica is a crucial element in this debate. It's a very delicate element in this debate. Not just because it's the only place in the world which has never sustained a human population and therefore remains relatively pristine in this respect, but more importantly because it holds in its ice cores 500,000-year-old carbon records trapped in its layers of ice. Mark this 3-4 lines, children. It's very important. He says that why one should go to Antarctica. It's not because human being or the human population is not sustained there, but because it is pristine, is original. It is still original in this respect, and still one can find the carbon records just trapped in its layers of ice. Okay, if we want to study and examine the Earth's past, present, future, Antarctica is a place to go. So he says that if we want to go, if the question comes that why one should go to Antarctica, so this is the answer, the last three, four lines, that it's not that human population has never sustained, but because it is really very original in this respect, and one can find carbon records trapped in its layers of ice. Okay, students on ice, the program I was working with on Solesky aims to do exactly this by taking high school students to the ends of the world and providing them with inspiring education opportunities which will help them foster means to develop a new understanding and respect for our planet. So why this group, Students on Ice program, why they wanted to take the students there? Because this will give them opportunity. This is an educational trip, and this will just give them opportunity to understand the better that how the Earth is in the present condition. It's being in operation for 6 years now, headed by Canadian Geoff Green, who got tired of transporting celebrities and retired rich curiosity seekers who could only give back in a limited way. He says that it's better in operation for 6 years now. So he has just given us this, that Students on Ice is a program headed by Canadian Geoff Green. He has chosen to take students to end of the world Antarctica. He wants to provide young students an opportunity to understand and respect the planet. Students are young. They are ready to learn and act. They can actually see the effect of global warming. They see glaciers retreating and ice shells collapsing. They cannot remain unaffected. They can see that the threat is real. So that's why he says that he wanted to take the young children with them. With Students on Ice, he offers the future generation of policy makers a life-changing experience at an age when they are ready to observe, learn, and most importantly, act. This is an age when they are not only able to learn and absorb, but they will act it also. Okay, and that's why he wanted to take these students. The reason the program has been so successful is because it's impossible to go anywhere near the South Pole and not be affected by it. So he says why it was successful, because it's impossible to go anywhere, okay, near South Pole and not be affected by it. It's easy to be blasé about polar ice caps melting while sitting in the comfort zone of our respective latitude and longitude, but when you can visibly see glaciers retreating and ice shells collapsing, you begin to realize that the threat of global warming is very real. So he says that it's very easy to sit in a drawing room and to see on the television that how the ice caps are melting. So you don't have that feeling, but when you experience it, you're feeling something else that becomes the more real. Antarctica because of her simple ecosystem and lack of biodiversity is a perfect place to study how little changes in the environment can have big repercussions, means results. So he says that Antarctica ecosystem is very simple and it lack the biodiversity, okay, and that's why a little change in the environment can give a very big result. Repercussions means results. Take the microscopic phytophyllanton, those grasses of the sea that nourish and sustain the entire Southern Ocean's food chain. So this is the only plant, phytoplankton is a type of grass which one can find in the sea. So this is the only grass which has maintained the food chain in Southern Ocean. These single cell plants use the sun's energy to assimilate means to absorb carbon and synthesis means produce something by combining different things, organic compounds in that wondrous and most important of processes called photosynthesis. So he says that because of this grass only, phytoplankton grass only, the whole food chain is possible because this single cell plants, they just absorb the energy from the sun, okay, and this plant only makes or process the photosynthesis, and that's why it is very important. This plant is really very important. Scientists warn that a further depletion in the ozone layer will affect the activities of phytoplankton, which in turn will affect the lives of all the marine animals and birds of the region and the global carbon cycle. So he says that if the scientists have just warned that if further there will be the depletion in the ozone layer, it will directly affect this grass, and if this grass will be affected, then the whole marine animals, birds, they all are going to affect, because this is a complete food chain, so they all are going to affect it. In the parable of the phytoplankton, there is a great metaphor for existence. So he says that if we just learn the moral, parable is a moral lesson, if we learn from this grass is take care of the small things and the big things will fall into place. That if you just take care of the smalls or the very small things in your life, the big things will take place in a very systematic order. This is very important, very very important. Just mark this as your long question, 6-mark question, and very important question from this chapter. That if you take care of the small things, the big things will fall into place. I mean, the big things will automatically be very systematic. Okay, so now it's walk on the ocean. I think up till here it's very much clear to you students. So let me just revise what we have just done, what we have read in the human impact. That human civilization is only 12,000 years old. It is only a few seconds old on the geological clock, but during this short period, man has caused much confusion. He has built towns, villages and cities and mega cities. He has wiped out many other species to grab limited natural resources. By burning fossil fuels, man has created a blanket of carbon dioxide around the world. This is rising the global temperature. This rise in temperature has caused climatic changes. It is the most hotly debated question many scientists foretell disaster. Antarctica is a place to see the impact of these changes because it has a simple ecosystem. A little change in the environment can trigger a big effect. For example, if we take the microscopic grass phytoplankton, they are single cell plants. Through photosynthesis, they absorb carbon to form organic compounds. They sustain the entire food chain in the southern oceans. They regulate the global carbon cycle. Any further depletion of ozone layer will cripple the grass. If they did not function, the entire food chain and global carbon cycle would collapse. Okay, so that's why he says that really this plant is very important. This is, they have given just one example that how if we just take care of the small things, the big things can or fall into their place at a very, in a very systematic way. The next is walk on the ocean. My Antarctic experience was full of epiphanies means moments of very strong emotions. Epiphanies means moments of very strong emotions. But the best occur just short of the Antarctic Circle at 65.55 degrees south. The Soleski had managed to wedge herself into a thick white stretch of ice between the peninsula of Tadpole Island, which was preventing us from going any further. Okay, so what he says that this journey was full of very strong emotions. So when they were on their journey and with them, they managed to wedge, they just managed to enter a very narrow space into a thick white stretch of ice between the peninsula and Tadpole Island, okay, which was preventing them to move any further. The captain decided we were going to turn around and head back north, but before we did, we were all instructed to climb down the gang flank. Okay, so he says that the captain just told that they have to just turn around and they are going to move to north. Before this, they all were told to climb down the gangplank. Gangplank is a board for walking between the boat and shore. Okay, and walk on the ocean. So there we were, all 52 of us. So how many were there in this group? 52. Knitted out in glow tags and glares, walking on a stark. Stark is only whiteness that seemed to spread out forever. Underneath our feet was a meter thick ice pack, and underneath that 180 meters of living, breathing salt water. So he said that they were walking on the ice. Okay, so it was a thick layer of the ice, and under that ice, okay, there was the salt water was there. In the periphery, carbiters seals were stretching and sunning themselves on ice floes, much like stray dogs will do under the shade of